This is part 5 of a series on attention networks. In this video, we'll take a look at the transformer model. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is generated by AI, text-to-speech. In the previous chapter, we looked at a sequence-to-sequence-based attention model. In this video, we'll look at a transformer model that uses only attention rather than a sequence model. Eight data scientists working at Google published a groundbreaking research paper in the field of natural language processing in 2017 called "Attention is All You Need." This is the transformer model. Transformer has excellent performance in processing sequence data and has a fast learning speed, so it is currently widely used in machine translation, chatbots, etc. The authors of the paper proposed a new simple network architecture, the transformer, based solely on attention mechanisms, dispensing with recurrence and convolutions entirely. The overall structure of the transformer is as follows, and it consists of an encoder and decoder, just like the models covered previously. This model was designed for natural language processing, but here we will apply it to time series forecasting. In later natural language processing tutorials, we will use it to create machine translators or chatbots. Now let's take a look at the internal structure of the transformer model one by one. Let's first look at how to feed time series data into a transformer model. Since transformer also has an encoder-decoder structure, the method of inputting data is the same as the existing seq-to-seq model. The example below is the data used in the previous seq-to-seq model. To learn how to construct your data for time series forecasting, see the first video in this series. The encoder input is fed into the encoder. The decoder input is fed into the decoder and make the target data come out as the output of the decoder. Each subset consists of 5 sequential data points. Natural language data may have padding tokens added to keep the length of the sequence constant, but time series data has no padding because the length is constant. If your data contains padding tokens, a padding mask operation is required. We will look at this later in the natural language processing tutorial. Since time series prediction is a regression problem, we do not use softmax in the output layer. Therefore, the outputs are real values, not probabilities. An embedding layer for the time series is added to the input layer. In natural language processing, word embedding layers are used, but since we are dealing with time series data, we use a simple linear feedforward layer for the embedding layer. The outputs of this layer are vector representations of the time series data. In this example, the first row is the embedding vector for the first data point in the time series. The size of the vector is a hyperparameter called dModel. Next, let's look at the positional encoding. Since the transformer contains no recurrence and no convolution, in order for the model to make use of the order of the sequence, we must inject some information about the relative or absolute position of the tokens in the sequence. For example, if we have a time series like this, the second and the fifth data points are equal to 2.5. The second 2.5 is on an upward path, and the fifth 2.5 is on a downward path. These are represented by the same vector, but must be handled differently. In the seek-to-seek model, this data is processed sequentially, one by one. The second 2.5 follows 1.2, and the fifth 2.5 follows 2.9. Therefore, the seek-to-seek model can distinguish between these two. However, in the transformer, these two will not be distinguished because this data is processed simultaneously in parallel. To solve this problem, the authors of the paper added positional encodings to the input embeddings at the bottoms of the encoder and decoder stacks. These data points are converted into embedding vectors. In this example, the size of the vector D model is 8. Since the second and fifth data points are identical, their embedding vectors will also be identical. If positional encodings are added here, these two will be different. The positional encodings have the same dimension D model as the embeddings, so that the two can be summed. There are many choices of positional encodings, learned and fixed. In this work, we use sine and cosine functions of different frequencies as follows. Let's say we simply use these sequentially increasing numbers to insert location information. Then, as the sequence gets longer, the position encoding values will continue to increase. And if large values are added to this data, the information in the time series may be distorted or lost. Therefore, we cannot simply use sequentially increasing numbers as positional encoding. We need a way to represent unique positional information while minimizing the impact on the original time series without continually increasing the information. One such method is to use sine and cosine functions of different frequencies. This vector always represents position 0, and this vector always represents position 1. These encoding vectors are all uniformly spaced, non-increasing, and non-overlapping. Now let's observe the position encoding vectors through code. The core part of the function that finds the position encodings is taken from this site. Using this function to get position encodings with time step 6 and D-model 8, we get the following results. This is a 6x8 matrix. The spacing between adjacent vectors is all the same. We use time step 20 and D-model 2 to obtain the positional encodings and visualize them as follows. The initial position encoding is at this point, and the next is at this point. This continues to cycle without overlapping. When the number of time steps is 20 and D model is 3, the results are as follows. Let's run this code. We get the following results. Next, let's take a look at the multi-head attention process. This is presented in section 3.2 of the paper. Let's walk through this process through a simple example. Let's assume that the encoder input X is as follows. This is the sum of the input embedding and the positional encoding. The D model is 6. And let's assume that the number of layers in the encoder is 1, and the number of heads in a layer is 2. DK is the value of D model divided by the number of heads. feed X into 3 linear projection layers. The number of neurons in each linear projection layer is 2. The parameters of each linear projection layer are WQ, WK, and WV. Each parameter is a 6x2 matrix. 6 is D model, and 2 is the value of D model divided by 3. The reason we divided it by 3 is because there are 3 Q, K, and V. Q stands for query, K stands for key, and V stands for value. The output of each linear projection layer is Q, K, and V. Compute the dot product of matrices Q and K. This is the self-attention of the input data X. The first row vector is the dot product between the vector at time step 1 and the remaining vectors. The first and third data points have the greatest similarity, and the first and fourth data points have the lowest similarity. Divide this by the square root of dk. Then we apply the softmax function to this matrix. This becomes the matrix of self-attention scores. If D model is large, the dot product value may also be large. If the dot product values are too large, the softmax values will be too close to 0 and 1. For example, the softmax value of this vector is like this. But the softmax value of this vector is like this. To avoid this, here we divide the dot product value by the square root of dk. Here dk is 3, calculated from the left. This is the scaled dot product. And then we multiply the attention score by the matrix V. This is a 5x2 matrix, the attention values of head 0. This is the process of the first head. And do the same thing for the second head. Figure 2 in the paper shows this process. The left figure shows the scaled dot product attention process, and the right figure shows the multi-head attention process. Q and K are multiplied, scaled, and softmax is applied. Then this result is multiplied by V. This output is the attention value. In this example, we use 2 heads. Then we concatenate the results from the 2 heads. This is the concatenated attention value. We feed this into another linear projection layer. So this is the output of multi-head attention. This is the multi-head attention process shown in this figure. Next, let's look at the process by which the encoder's output is generated. We add X to the multi-head attention we just computed. This is the residual connection we looked at in the highway network video. And then we apply the layer normalization to the result. And we feed the results into a position-wise feedforward network. Then the outputs of this network are as follows. And we compute the sum of this output and this matrix. Then we apply the layer normalization to the result. This is the final output of the encoder. Finally, let's look at the masked multi-head attention process of the decoder, and the process by which the output of the decoder is generated. Let's first look at the masked multi-head attention process. The multi-head attention process in the decoder is the same as that in the encoder, but a mask process is added. Again, in the seek-to-seek model, data points are processed sequentially. If we are currently processing T3, we can compute the dot product of T1 and T2 and the dot product of T1 and T3. We can't compute the dot product of T1 and T4 because we don't know T4 yet. However, the transformer processes this in parallel, so the dot product is computed all at once. Therefore, we need to use a look-ahead mask to avoid computing the dot product of the current and future data points. We create a look-ahead mask matrix like this, multiply it by negative infinity, and then add it to the scaled dot product result. And then we apply softmax to the result. Then the lower triangular matrix becomes the attention score. The process of obtaining the multi-head attention value using this score is identical to that of the encoder. This is the masked multi-head attention process in the decoder. The add and layer normalization processes are the same as the encoder. And this result and the output of the encoder become Q, K, and V. And the multi-head attention values between the encoder and the decoder are calculated. This process is identical to the multi-head attention of the encoder. The only differences are the inputs Q, K, and V. The subsequent steps are identical to those of the encoder. In this way, we can get the outputs of the decoder and pass them to the output layer. This is how a transformer model works. So far, we have looked at the architecture of the transformer model. In the next video, we will write code to predict a time series using a transformer model.